The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency and its federal partners conducted a multi-year project to test and evaluate decontamination techniques for a biological incident. BOTE, the BioResponse Operational Testing and Evaluation Project, collected data to compare the success and cost of cleanup methods.
The decontamination options that were chosen for the BOTE project considered many factors, from the effectiveness that was determined through lab studies, such as what's done in our labs here in Research Triangle Park, North Carolina, as well as past use in the fields, as well as capability of that potential decontamination option to be effective.
EPA plays an important role in helping to prepare and protect our country against chemical, radiological, and biological threats. So it's necessary to test decontamination techniques in real-world situations to put the best methods into practice. The BOTE project also examined the cost of each method, damage caused to the facility, management of the waste cleanup, and potential recontamination risks.
We basically simulate a biological terrorist attack. We release an aerosol, a harmless aerosol, that's, mimics or kind of simulates what a biological threat would look like.
The test facility was modeled on homes and office buildings and included a variety of materials that required decontamination, like carpet, fabric, and wood.
One of the goals of the BOTE project was to help us develop an exposure assessment plan. To do this, we needed to measure the concentration of viable spores in the air before and after each remediation activity.
Participants collected about 250 samples before and after decontamination to test the effectiveness of three methods, one using pH-adjusted bleach, the other two using different fumigants.
Basically, our process involves flash vaporizing hydrogen peroxide into a dried airstream and blowing this into a space that's to be decontaminated. We're blowing it down a pipe into this enclosure, and then it's very toxic to these organisms, okay? And in it, we're killing them virtually with hundreds of parts per million, which is a very low concentration. And the reason people prefer this is because you can disperse it in areas. It gets into many cracks and crevices. Inside the enclosure, hydrogen peroxide degrades to water and oxygen. There's no residue. And it's friendly to lots of electronics and things.
The second technology we're looking at is a low-tech procedure. It's using pH amended bleach or pH adjusted bleach. It's taking household bleach, some household vinegar, diluting that with water, and spraying it on surfaces.
If you do liquid bleach on surfaces, you're going to have to throw some of those surfaces away, so there's a waste stream. And that waste stream, you have to characterize it because the cost is involved with it.
And after we remove all the items, we are basically hosing down the entire building with the solution. And there is a 5-minute contact time that we want, and we're going on the surfaces, and we're going to do that twice. So for a total of 10-minute contact time on the surface of the amended bleach on the surface to kill the spores.
We use three precursor chemicals brought together within a water stream to make the chlorine dioxide gas, and then that's held temporarily in a solution tank from which it's pulled out of and put into the trailer that you see behind me, which is basically a horizontal cooling tower. We strip the gas out of the solution and put it into the air phase and then circulate it through the building.
The unit is mobile and is made up of two closed-loop systems, one that carries the chlorine dioxide while the other transfers air into and out of an emitter.
Chlorine dioxide is an oxidant, and because it's an oxidant, it's going to go after the things that are electron-rich. And we do have oxidation of metals. It's the common garden variety steels, or the mild steels that you see the main corrosion issues with.
The study results found that the effectiveness of each decontamination method varied based on certain conditions, like the amount of humidity and temperature in the room.
The goal was to bring the researchers together with the EPA responders to bring the research to the field, to bring it to them, to let them use it in the field, to bring some lessons learned back to the lab to figure out what can we do better from this, how can we improve and meet our goal.
The results of this research will help provide state and local leaders, on-scene coordinators, and waste managers with effective decontamination guidelines in the event of a biological threat. The information will also help guide future decontamination decisions and ensure a more effective response to biological incidents.